This is the Barnstable County Regional Government. This is the Board of Regional Commissioners. It is March 7th, 2018. It is scheduled to start our meeting at 10 o'clock in the morning. It is 10:02 by the clock on the wall. We are meeting at the Commissioners' Meeting Room at the Superior Courthouse at 3195 Main Street in Barnstable, Mass., and I'm about to call the meeting to order. First of all, if you'd all stand and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge of allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. And if y'all could just please remain standing, I'd like to have a moment of silence for all those that died in the service of our country, and keep in our prayers those that are currently serving. Excellent. Thank you very much. Is there any members of the public here that are recording this meeting other than our county staff? Seeing none. Is there any members of the public that would like to come up and comment on any issue to the regional commissioners today? Seeing none. No. Let's see here. It's going to give me a second. Make sure I have my paperwork here. Owen, do you want me to announce to have people who are here in the room sign in on the shine-in sheet so we can show their names, or is that just for people who want to speak? Okay, thank you. And there's no member of the public. All right. Going to go to number five, which is approval of the minutes. We only have 1 minute in front of us. I'm looking for someone to move the approve the regular meeting minutes of February 28th, 2018 as presented.
So moved.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. Is there any questions on those? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. General business. We have a report from Diane Murphy, Fisheries and Agricultural Specialist. Yes? No?
Yes. Yes, sir. Actually, there's two of us reporting.
Yeah. Joshua is also here. Come on up.
Same
yeah. From the Marine Program, you traveled to the Milford Agricultural Seminar in Skelton, Connecticut.
Yes. Yes, we were in...
Did you bring us anything, too? He's not from you, right?
We were discussing that. No.
They don't. Hey, you know what? I want a Sharpie. I want something.
The science conferences are kind of hardcore. There's not much.
I don't know how we can compete with that.
That's pretty good, isn't it?
Yes.
Look, they see. See, the health department listens.
Well, we can't compete with that.
Next time.
Okay, thank you. Just kidding. Tell us what went on down in Connecticut.
Actually, this was the 38th annual Milford Aquaculture Seminar. So this has been running quite a long time, and it's at the Milford... it's put on by the Milford Lab. So we were there. I was only there for one of the days, unfortunately, and that was because I was a co-author on one of the presentations, the grant that we have, the GIS sighting tool for shellfish aquaculture. And there were actually members of Barnstable that were there, as well as other folks from some of the agencies like Nature Conservancy that had keen interest in this. Primarily, the lectures that I was able to be present for were concerned with kelp aquaculture, and that's something that's in its nascent development right now. And we were able to hear presentations from Connecticut Sea Grant and the Connecticut Bureau of Aquaculture and how they're dealing with this new industry. And this helps to provide us with information moving forward, so we're not going to reinvent the wheel as this industry develops. They're currently, with the lack of federal guidelines on the production and processing of seaweeds, this is, you know, developing, so we wanted to stay on top of that. As a matter of fact, after this particular meeting, Josh had put together a workshop meeting with many members of the public and industry, to as well as regulators, to really examine this further. So I think you had people come from Connecticut, Rhode Island, for that meeting.
Yep.
And then we heard presentations from the University of Connecticut on the hatchery technology. We had presentations from HUI, Woods Hole Oceanographic Institution. They're working on ways to improve productivity and composition of kelp, looking at this as a potential feedstock for biofuels. Then we heard from Salem State on their mussel, longline mussel culture project, which is in the offshore waters off Cape Ann. And this is something else as aquaculture continues to develop, particularly in our region, many of these areas are more potential is offshore and hoping to sort of build off their pilot programs. And then we had the pleasure of listening to the final talk that I heard was on IMTA, Integrated Multitrophic Aquaculture, and that was by a Korean fellow who came here from Korea to present on work that they were doing with combining seaweed aquaculture and the culture of fish to sort of one would remediate the other as far as, you know, the fish feeds that end up in the water. It's hopefully the excess nutrients are taken up by the seaweeds and the bivalves, the oysters. So that was very interesting to hear.
Can you elaborate on that just a little bit more? I'm missing this now. The kelp attracts the fish, or
no,
the
well,
kelp
these are all,
will eat
these,
up the nutrients?
These are all farms, so they're right. Farming the fish, and multi-trophic, so it's different levels within, you know, the environment, and they, yeah, so you'll have producers as well as consumers that are sort of held in one unit to remediate the other. And the kelp will takes up excess nutrients, as does for growth, as do shellfish. So, in you know, as and the fish are the fed producers, and when they, you know, release
excrement.
I was like, trying to think of a good word. It helps to remediate.
Covers just about everything.
It helps to remediate that.
There's less waste, hopefully.
Yeah, and this is not a new technology. It's a newer technology. I mean, there's folks in different states, particularly in New England, doing this. But
when they actually farm kelp, mm-hmm. is sorry my ignorance in this. Can you seed an area and then wait until it comes a certain length and height, and then you harvest it?
That's actually what you do. You produce the seed on ropes, on lines in the lab, and then you deploy that out into a water body, and then they're already attached to something,
cool.
Very, very minuscule, and then they grow in the water, and then you can harvest them at maybe...
Just pulling in the rope once they've gotten
generally,
well,
yes.
Yeah.
It's simplistic, but yes.
And they grow over winter, which is unusual, so...
No kidding.
It's a winter crop.
Which makes that very desirable.
Has there been a lot of, you guys must be working with the health department too, has there been a lot of looking into how much nitrogen this kelp might absorb as compared to shellfish? Because I know we're focusing on shellfish as a remediation, mm-hmm. if you will, for the nitrogen loading in our estuaries, but should we also maybe be looking at kelp farms?
Yeah, there's been some work on that. The challenge there is, kelp likes to grow offshore rather
okay.
than the highly impacted nearshore waters. So it's probably going to have less of an impact, you know, being grown out in offshore waters.
Does kelp grow on the bottom offshore too, or does it grow in a suspended, you know, water body, water tower, or whatever it's called out there?
The farms do it suspended, but
they do.
Naturally it's found on the bottom.
It's on the bottom.
Yeah.
Cool. Wow. A lot of stuff.
And
you guys any questions?
The second day was mostly about shellfish disease stuff, so I'll
we're not done.
Say that. There's some stuff on Long Island going on in conjunction with Diane here to learn how quahogs might be resistant to a disease, QPX, that's caused widespread mortalities. And then
EPX?
QPX.
QPX, okay.
Quahog parasite unknown. That's the name of it. So, there's a lot of work there, and right now we don't have any disease-resistant stocks to breed, so... If QPX is a problem in your area, you're pretty much out of luck trying to grow them there because they're just going to end up dead.
So when you're talking about disease resistant,
into like genetic engineering or something?
It's not engineering. They identify the genes responsible and breed ones that are more resistant to getting the disease.
One species of quahog or something like
it's
that?
It's all the same species of quahog. It's just the ones that are more resistant to disease.
Yeah, much like traditional farming we've bred.
And how would you know which are and which are not?
It's like they look at the genes to be able to identify those, what's responsible for more resistance.
So they're not going and doing anything with the genes themselves?
No, they're not taking genes from one species or another animal and inserting it. It's
they're just weeding out the good,
selective.
Selective breeding.
Thank you.
Mendel's
selective
peas
breeding.
Or whatever.
We do it on the farm all the time. Mm-hmm.
And Diane, for years, has done test plots, and you take the survivors, and then they go and look at the survivors and see why they're different from the ones that don't do so well.
Right. So our the work that's being done in Barnstable County is supporting that research through the studies that we've done at different study sites throughout the Cape. We're integral to that research.
And there's a number of talks on other endemic diseases to oysters, and again, why certain strains of oysters seem to be more productive or more robust to disease issues than others. Oysters are a step ahead, I think, than the clams or quahogs are. And then a lot of interesting stuff about harmful algal blooms, which are sort of an emerging issue in our area. We've had a couple issues with those in recent years, so it was all very helpful stuff to learn the most up-to-date science, what's going on with those problems throughout the region, not just here on the Cape.
So when you guys go on these conferences and whatnot, seminars, besides giving like a verbal report to us or to your department, do you like maintain a record or some sort of a diary of what you picked up or something like that, or something you can refer back to? Or
certainly try to, yeah. And you know, I'm writing these up, I guess, you know, that part of that goes into it. So yeah, try to.
Beyond the notes that we take, it's also the connections and the interaction we make with the other researchers or extension agents at these conferences, and which we then follow up with. So it's we not only do we hear them at the conference, but then it's the follow up that happens later on. And
you also stated though that the first day that you were there, Barnstable County, you went and actually did a presentation.
I did not deliver the presentation. I was co-author on that presentation, but most of the time.
It's kind of an open. We're not only going there just as viewers.
Oh no.
But some of the stuff.
Participants.
We're actually
most
going
of the
there
time
as,
we give a presentation
right,
or two.
Right, right. Yep. Or at least involved
to share
in
the information.
Mm-hmm. And that's the whole thing about and just cooperating together with all of us are facing the same things up and down the seashore here. So
right, and you learn that you're not in the same boat. You tend to get sort of I would call it the sort of parochial blinders when you go out beyond your border or go over the bridge and start talking with folks from other states. You realize you're not alone, and that networking helps to inform the work you do trying to deal with the issues that you have. It's not isolated alone. It's often shared.
So. Anything else from us?
No.
You guys, anything else?
Interesting.
Thank you very much.
Thank
appreciate you.
You
coming in and giving us an update.
Thanks. Thank you.
That's going to bring us to the county reimbursement policy for employees and elected officials. Mm-hmm. It has come to my attention that the current employee elected official reimbursement policy and procedure manual. Couple of things. Number one, I can't find any evidence that this has been officially adopted by the county commissioners, number one. Number two, although we do follow it to the and some of the things that are in here, the actual document has not been run by not only county council but certainly our finance department to make sure that it is follows the rules and laws laid out by either the Internal Revenue, who I believe have jurisdiction over this, and certainly our finance department. So today I just want to let you guys know that I do not anticipate a vote on this.
Okay.
What I anticipate is if there's any individual input that you might have on it, now's a good time to let staff know about it. I would like to refer it back to staff, especially the finance department and Jack, and have them come bring us a document that we'll put back on that we know has been approved by all the different variation departments that need to approve it. Again, as I mentioned, the Internal Revenue, making sure that we follow. Some of the questions that you want to think about is, do we want to follow on the calculation aspect of this? Do we want to follow Internal Revenue recommended standards? Do you want to make up your own standards? Do we want to have a, there may even be some standards from the state of Massachusetts, I'm not really positive on it. But at some point we have to make a determination. And again, this deals with the calculation of mileage, when people are using their vehicles to go back and forth to meetings. It also, as the two that just made the presentation here that went off to a conference out of state, it does refer to, and in it has a meals reimbursement chart, which states how much that we will reimburse someone for a meal. A breakfast is a set amount, lunch is a set amount, and dinner is a set amount. It also even has language in here about how much of a tip we will reimburse them for. So these are things that I want to make sure that you have a chance to look over and you're okay with them. This document, I'm going to refer to it as being in draft form, because again, I cannot seem to have found any voted or official version, although aspects of this have been implemented. But one thing that has been brought up is hotel rooms, and in under the page 6 under the hotel and airfare, there was a sentence in here that the county will not exceed payment for hotel rooms in excess of the standard hotel conference room rate. There's been some discussion about some people having an upgrade to rooms, going from what would be the standard conference rate.
Like the MMA conference or something?
Even the conference that these two that just reported to us on, I'm sure, the hotel, they were in Connecticut, staying at a hotel, right?
I did it all one day.
How about, what's his name that was with you?
He stayed.
He stayed. Mm-hmm. So at that conference, they must offer a room rate for the conference participants.
It's usually
discounted rate. Yeah, so it's usually, most of these affairs have things like that, whatever it is. I'm sure this conference that we were just talking about, the Marine Program, I mean the Milford Agricultural Seminar in Connecticut, I'm sure if you called the Connecticut Hotel and you said you were with them, they would have some discounted rate. It may not be a great one, it might just be their standard room rate. My point is, though, I don't think the county should be in a position that someone decides to go down to Connecticut and go to that seminar and get a suite with a fireplace overlooking the river at 4 times what the room rate is being offered. So that language needs to be put in here. Same thing with upgrading to first class. I mean, there is language already in here that states that if someone does air travel, anyone who, that we would only be paying for the coach. And if someone wants to fly first class, then that would be on them. They certainly can fly first class, but the county doesn't need to be on the hook for reimbursing it.
And well, I was going to say, usually the organizations that sponsor these meetings also arrange with hotels to get a specific rate for the people attending.
Absolutely.
I mean, yeah, so yeah. You wouldn't have to pay the regular hotel rate. You
could actually pay a discount.
If the organization...
Right. But if they
knew
don't,
that a lot of their members would have to have hotels.
If they don't offer a reduced rate, though, then I think there needs to be some clerical language in here that states that the only thing that's in here right now is it says in excess of the standard hotel conference room fee. Well, who's standard? Yeah. It needs to be defined a little better. And this is why the IRS, believe it or not, may have to weigh in on this. I think there's a chart that says if you're going to stay in Boston area, the standard hotel rate is, I'm just going to throw a number out, it's not it, $100 a night. If you're staying in Dallas, Texas, it's going to be $120 a night. If you're staying in New York City, the standard might be $170 a night. It might, you know what I mean? So we have to determine and look into this to make sure that we do have a policy that we can stand behind, that's all. So those are the issues that I want to look into, and I do believe that staff is well prepared to do this. I think, Jack, you said you'd be more than happy to take a look at it and work with the finance department, making sure that it meets all our requirements as far as the any laws providing.
So I have a question. For example, like, I know the Assembly of Delegates gets mileage reimbursement traveling to and from their meetings. Is this going to impact what they've been doing all along, or probably not?
Not so much in travel reimbursement, because I believe that the outcome is on this is going to be that we're going to adopt some either IRS standard, and I think travel reimbursement is 58 cents a mile. I mean, there's a standard rate for that. So,
and that's what
it's less than that, 48, 38 cents, 58 cents, whatever it is. There's a standard that we would
presently, but I think that's a little high under the current IRS standards.
Yeah.
So we might have to adjust that.
Yeah. So
what do they get now? Pretty much what you just mentioned.
I think it's 55 now in our policy, but come July 1st, we will apply the rate that IRS recommends.
Okay, so it may or may not change.
Right. It goes up and down based on gas prices. Okay.
Actually, you're right. The current mileage reimbursement is currently 55 cents. So if we were to attach this to some kind of an IRS ruling, then it would fluctuate. But this document needs to reflect that, and presently it doesn't. So.
Yeah. Oh, is the Assembly the only group that has reimbursement for?
Oh, no, everybody does. All our department heads do.
We don't, as far as I know, but.
You can put in for mileage.
Yeah, well, I'm so close. But she travels from Falmouth.
Yeah.
I've never thought of it. I've never knew that anybody ever, except for meetings, you know, like the MMA meetings or something like that. Yeah. I've never been with any organization that provides travel reimbursement.
No, we do as a policy for the, and it includes all elected officials and employees.
So briefly in this, the mileage reimbursement is addressed in the vehicle policy that we have just adopted, and it is on the IRS standard.
That's why this
so
was
as
being
of
updated.
July, yeah, just so it will be, it is addressed already in the vehicle policy for the IRS standard. So it does go down this year.
Right.
And it, like I said earlier when I yelled out, it does go by gas prices, so it fluctuates every year.
Right.
So it just hasn't been addressed in a few years. I think that 55 cent rate was back in 2013.
So you think that it's going to go down a little bit?
It is going down. Yep. It's you know, pennies. Like, gotcha. I think it's 48 cents.
It's 54.5, I believe, and IRS comes up with the rate every January.
So back in the room,
so this would have to get changed every year.
So
this won't have to get changed. The policy will not have to be changed. The policy will just say the county is hereby adopting the standards set forth by the IRS.
Okay.
And then those policy reimbursement things that go out to everybody would have the going rates on them, if that's the way we choose to go. We have other ways to go, too, but that seems to be the way that we want to go because that's the way our previous policies have been addressed.
So when do you want to put this up for a vote?
Not until it's done. I would like a consensus of us to send it back to staff and have them come back to us with a completed document that not only coincides with our current policies that we have adopted, but also defines better. And the only problems I have is the definition of standard hotel room. So I'll make notes on this if you want. And make sure that we have clarification on upgrades to first class and flying. The people, we're only playing coach. Those are the kind of things that I think that I saw a problem that wasn't defined good enough.
Yeah. Question, eligibility. Does it define eligibility?
It does. At the front of it, it says employees and elected officials.
Reimbursement.
So, yes.
Okay.
So do you want to give a target date or do you want to leave it open-ended?
No, I think we could just leave it open-ended. I think it's going to come back next week. I'll keep pressure on them. It shouldn't be a big deal to change this.
Okay.
So. And that'll give you guys a chance to review it. And if you have comments, have them go directly to Jack. Or I believe Mary is going to spearhead this because this is more of a finance thing than a human resource thing. So if you have any comments after you review it, just talk it over with Mary.
Actually, it's probably a human resource consulting
finance. Don't go there. Shh, don't go there, please.
Whatever.
We've already decided
that?
It's gonna
be.
Okay, great. I'm not going to take any action on it. I think it's pretty clear. And again, anybody have any input on it, feel free to move forward and send your things to them. New business not anticipated by the chair. I don't have any other than I see Sean in the room. Sean, once again, we have a storm coming. Do you want to say anything now in regards to the storm under this new business that's coming? You did the same thing last week. Or should I just take it upon myself to warn people that here we are Wednesday evening, or Wednesday afternoon at, or Wednesday morning, I should say, at 10:30, and Wednesday night, tonight, we're expecting to get hit with another nor'easter, so.
Well, I think we were going to give you a quick update from the previous storm.
Why don't you come up then?
Yeah, all right.
Because I don't think you're on the agenda, are you?
No.
No.
So let's do it here then.
New business.
Right. So under new business, I am going to declare that we're going to have an update, a brief update of the previous storm, and certainly some discussions on wire outages and things like that that we may be expecting for this new one that I did not know about when I put this agenda together on Monday. So go
sure.
for it.
Excellent. Thank you. Well, Phil, why don't you give a quick update what's going to happen this week?
Sure. So, tonight's will mainly be just a short-lived, quick rain and wind maker, so nothing compared to what we just went through. No coastal flooding. There'll be minor splash over, some additional erosion, but nothing like what we just went through. I mean, that was essentially five hot high tide cycles of erosion and 3 to 4 of significant coastal flooding. We won't see anything of that nature.
So this one that's coming tonight is fairly fast moving. You don't think it's going to be around on Friday? Or?
It's in and out of here. It'll start to rain this afternoon, pours tonight. Tapers to drizzle, and then maybe switches over to a little snow before it ends tomorrow morning. But if this is an interior New England snowstorm, we'll get some wind out of it, but it'll be nothing like.
So Worcester and Framingham, those areas.
Yeah, probably a solid foot out there. But for us, I mean, in terms of power outages, I don't think it'll really cause any additional issues. If there's any areas that are sort of weak and maybe weren't quite put back together, really well. Those areas could be susceptible to a little bit, but it'll be 50 to 60. I mean, we blew here at the county, we gusted to 93 miles per hour the other night. So that's a totally different animal. This will be 50 to 65, pretty typical Cape Cod nor'easter. Cool. Nothing like what we went through.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, and did you want to give us a little kind of background on what we went through, this horrific?
Yes, it was.
Surprise, but certainly.
It was a heck of a storm. It was, And Phil, correct me if I'm wrong, we had a front that actually had the storm stall over us, and that's why we had so many high tide cycles that we went through, and also dealing with a full moon at the time too. So between the fact that it was a high tide because of the full moon, and the fact that the way the wind was pushing everything in, water never really left in significant amounts when the low tides came through. So we constantly had high water, and from our offices, we could see behind the village here, water right up behind the Dolphin and in that whole area there. It was pretty impressive the amount of water that was moved by this storm. during the storm, we set up, a Mac on Friday morning, 6 a.m.
Just for the people at home, what does MAC stand
for? A MAC is the Multi-Agency Coordination Center for Barnstable County. We actually began with conference calls on Thursday. Opened up the MAC on Friday morning. We were open by 6 a.m. In the Multi-Agency Coordination Center, we have approximately 8 people working. We have representatives from Eversource, from the Mass Emergency Management Agency, the Barnstable County Incident Management Team, and the Barnstable County Department of Health and Environment. And we basically work on the resource requests that we need as a part of the storm event. What was really interesting this time is we saw this storm and we saw different phases as to how our response needed to be. So in the beginning of the storm, we did not anticipate having any shelters opened up. But as we started to move towards the end of the event, we saw a need for shelters. And we can talk a little bit about that too. So we began. At the height of the storm, we had about 125 homes without power, 125,000, homes without power. And that was, so we really started to see the power outages occurring on the Friday night.
And as of right now, when I came in this morning, we were down to about 185. Just 185 customers across the Cape. And so I think on the whole, we saw Eversource do a pretty good job. They brought a lot of crews in from out of the area. We had crews from Canada, New Hampshire, Western Mass, and even some from Connecticut coming up to help us out with the restoration process. During these events too, we also look at critical facilities. So there were times when we were looking at police departments, fire departments, hospitals without power. They were running on generator. Our goal is to try to get them off generator as quickly as possible and back onto that. And at one point, we had probably a half a dozen, Phil, police and fire departments that were running on generator during this event. So as the storm progressed on, and we started to go through these tidal cycles, but also with the high winds, we realized that as we're going into this and we're into day two and three of people without power, we had to start looking at a sheltering program too. And so I'm going to let Phil take over because Phil runs the sheltering program. He's going to give you just a quick update as to what we had to do with the shelters.
Yeah, so as Sean mentioned, going into it, we had not really anticipated it being a sheltering event. I mean, I think from like a weather perspective, it looked like 70, 80 miles per hour would be kind of where we'd max out, that wouldn't lead to really substantial power outages. There was no snow expected, really. But it became clear by Friday evening that we were in trouble. We were up to, like Sean mentioned, about 120,000 customers out, and Eversource had basically called a stop. They weren't doing anything. The wind was just too high. They can't put people up in bucket trucks. So we knew that by Saturday, if we weren't seeing drastic improvement in the morning, we were going to need to do something with sheltering. So REPC Executive Committee met via phone, I think it was Saturday midday. Mm-hmm. We polled all the towns to see what they were getting for shelter requests, and there were certainly a lot of people calling into their local dispatch centers, police, fire, asking for where they could go because they were cold inside their homes. So we opted to open Cape Tech, Barnstable Intermediate School, and the Falmouth High School for sheltering. So those facilities were open beginning Saturday evening, late afternoon, I believe. All these dates are blurring together in my mind. And we ran them through Monday morning, although we closed Falmouth and Barnstable a little bit earlier.
When you activate these shelters, who are some of the people or groups that staff them?
Sure. So they're essentially almost all volunteer run, which is a critical piece to this whole thing. Like, this really wouldn't work without the volunteers that make this work. So, and we have a pretty robust volunteer program on the Cape. So between Medical Reserve Corps, Cape Cod DART, which runs an animal component, and there's an LCAF, which is a lower Cape animal component that runs. We have ham radio operators in there, American Red Cross in there, and then of course the county's AmeriCorps program. There'd be essentially with this particular event, there's absolutely no way it would have worked if we hadn't had the AmeriCorps volunteers. It would have completely fallen flat on its face, just because they're an instantaneous response for us. So if we deploy them, they're out the doors. They're ready.
And they're trained in disaster relief.
Yeah, and so they were critical. And all the volunteer agencies are. We have agencies that are willing to stay on standby with us, too, throughout the entire thing. So people are getting on conference calls with us every 6 to 12 hours and constantly in contact with them.
Is the Medical Reserve Corps component run out of the county?
It is. Run out of the health department.
The county health department. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah, we have some grant funding to keep that program going.
Okay.
So we have two part-time people that do that work.
Okay. Yeah, and there's CERT teams across the community emergency response teams, which typically run through police departments across the Cape.
What's that mean?
CERT, community emergency response team.
Okay.
CERT. So there's a couple CERT teams across the Cape that participate, and then generally there's a local law enforcement or local EMS presence inside the shelters as well. And the Red Cross shipped up folks from New York City. I know we had a team from New York City that was running at least in Harwich and I believe in Barnstable. And so that sheltering operation went into, as long as I've got my dates all set here, I think that was Monday morning. We were fortunate in a way that we had we actually were able to open up. Well, I was called fortunate, unfortunate. I said we didn't really want to have to do it, but we were very fortunate the county let us do it. We opened up the Harborview Conference Room, even as a sort of a short-term shelter if we needed to. So we set up cots in there for the Sunday night period into Monday morning, just in case any folks in the Mid and Upper Cape needed to get warm. And we did have an individual in there.
Yeah, a lot of it, too, with just helping people with charging stations to be able to charge their cell phones.
Warming up.
Yep. Warming up.
As opposed to being sheltering that they could not go back into their homes to sleep. So.
And the fact that our shelters are in schools, it makes it really critical for us to get those schools back open. So on the Sunday night, it was important for us. We had found out that Monomoy and Cape Tech was going to be closed on Monday, but Falmouth and Barnstable were planning to be open. So we needed to get the Barnstable and the Falmouth shelter closed, so school could be open the next day. Because the sooner the schools are open, we start going in, you're into recovery phase. As a part of the response to the disaster, everything goes back to the norm. But we did, so one night we did actually have, Harborview open as a potential overnight if people needed it, but we didn't need it.
Yeah. Right. I noticed, and this might have been separate from you, that the American Red Cross on South Street in Hyannis was bulging with vehicles of people. Was that open for something?
They ended up running yesterday, or Monday, excuse me, what was the term?
I think we were calling it a reception center.
Reception center. Yeah. So they had some folks there, but they also use that for their logistics.
Okay.
So there are always going to be
like
people in there.
It looked like a busy
place
today.
It was a very busy place.
Yeah.
So we moved things. We moved a lot of equipment as well, by the way. Even before the storm, we had pre-positioned high water vehicles all throughout the Cape. The Mass Emergency Management agency was fantastic. We were able to make sure that there were two high water vehicles.
Did you get an Army truck back from Provincetown, or are they holding on to it?
Our Army truck did not fare very well.
Uh-oh.
Yeah, it made it to probably the fence line and then it was backed in.
Right.
So
we tried.
Yeah, we tried, and that was good. We had
we did send them sandbags, though.
We did send them sandbags, and that was a key that was really important too. Is for Provincetown and some of the towns that went back and had AmeriCorps come in and fill up sandbags. It was
so AmeriCorps did the sandbags.
They did all the sandbagging for the towns. It was absolutely incredible. So. We saw a couple of things that really kind of shined on this. Number one, we had four folks from AmeriCorps working with us in the MAC, and they handled all of the calls. So any calls for resource requests into the Multi-Agency Coordination Center first went through AmeriCorps, and then they went to us. That was our job afterwards, was to fulfill the resource requests. The second thing was Andrew Platt. Became a shelter manager, I think, as soon as he got into Harwich, and he did a great job running the shelter, and so we were pretty happy with that too.
That was the one at the tech school.
That was the one at the tech school. So we saw quite a storm, and we saw a lot of different facets to it. Over the next couple of weeks, we're going to be doing after action reports and after action meetings to see, okay, maybe there's some things that we can do better. Maybe there are some things that can be consolidated a little bit more. But I get the feeling that the way this storm hit, we're probably going to be looking at a declared disaster event.
Yeah.
So at this point, Mass Emergency Management Agency is out doing damage assessments, and they're going to start keeping track of the cost and starting to add up the cost and see if we're a declared event.
So what does that entail, once it's on the federal level, you mean?
On the federal level.
So what does that entail? Does that bring in federal dollars?
It does. It brings in federal, brings in FEMA dollars, to reimbursement to the communities for the cost for their storm response.
Right.
So it's usually a 75% reimbursement for every dollar that they spend on the storm. Mm-hmm. So it covers some of the overtime that police and fire may have had. Might cover some of the vehicle repairs, might cover some of the support functions that were needed as a part of the response.
And didn't the governor already declare
it? He declared a state of emergency, which actually starts that process.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Well, we're getting a little beyond the report, so I'll let you go. And then if you guys want, by all means, let Owen know, and I'll put you on the agenda for next week. We can have some discussion.
Right.
But.
And thank you very much.
I just want to say there's a handful. At some point, it'd be great. There'd be a handful of organizations that would be nice to sort of formally recognize for some of the stuff they did. RTA was fantastic throughout the entire thing.
Well, we're going to rely on you guys to maybe put together a little list of thank you note kind of thing, and then I can just put it on the agenda real quick as acknowledgement and execution, and then the three commissioners will sign it and send it off. So.
Awesome.
And the other thing I just want to leave you with that you guys may want to make a presentation to the commissioners in regards to that sandbag machine relatively soon. Maybe we can have that discussion and move forward.
Sounds good.
If, you know, it looks like it might help us in the future here.
Excellent. Sounds good. Thank
you very much.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. We're pretty much all done with that now. We're going to go on to 8, which is the commissioners' regular action items. The first thing we have up is authorization approval of the timesheet of Jack Units. I'd be looking for someone to move to approve the timesheet of Jack Units, county administrator, for the period of February 18, 2018 through March 3, 2018, as presented.
So moved.
Second.
Been moved in second. Any questions? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. The next one is an execution of an extension for the regional wide area network agreement with Open Cape Corporation. I am not going to entertain a motion to move this forward today, and there's a number of reasons why. I found some discrepancies in the actual contract that I do believe there needs to be language added in there in regards to monies being subject to appropriation, which is a common kind of a bulletproof thing that we put in, because this board cannot allocate and enter into contracts without that language in there for future boards and future budgets. Number one. Number two, it also was brought to my attention very late, otherwise I wouldn't have even put this on the agenda, that it appears that our purchasing department has ruled that because this contract has already been extended once, it cannot be extended a second time under the procurement laws of Massachusetts General Law 30B. So we were going to have to put this out for a RFP. So because of those reasons, I do not want to see this move forward today. If any of you have any comments, as I did specifically on the language for making sure that the monies are appropriated, I forget the actual term we use, subject to appropriation, needs to be in the new contract. If you go through it and you have any things like that that you want to discuss, feel free to either call Steve or Elaine Davis, purchasing department, and they'll be happy to walk you through the way we're going to handle this in the future. So again, I'm taking that off. Any other comments or discussion on that one? Brings us to C, which is a discharge of a mortgage. I'm looking for someone to move to authorize the execution of a discharge of a mortgage by Francis X. Hurry, Jr. to Barnstable County, acting through the Cape Cod Commission, dated February 21st, 2001, as presented.
So moved.
That's second. Been moved in, seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. That brings us to commissioner's reports. Commissioner Beattie, do you have anything?
Sure. I've been sort of trying to help out AmeriCorps house some of their members. So at 2 o'clock this afternoon, AmeriCorps members are going to, and I'm going to try to be there as well, are going to be given a tour by Barnstable Town Councilor Phil Wallace. He's going to give us a tour of the Payne Black House in 149. We're going to try to get into discussions to try to house some people there if possible. So that's it.
Great. Anything else, Commissioner Flynn?
No.
Okay, I have a couple of things. I plan on attending a meeting at the Joint Base Cape Cod tomorrow. They're doing a Army Community Partnership Program, and one of the reasons why I think it's important for, you know, myself, and I think Jack, and I think Steve is going too, we're going to be looking up that very issue that you just mentioned, Commissioner Beattie, the possibility of maybe discussing the future of AmeriCorps with them. It's a situation, we need to talk about it. And also, it's just interesting to find out what they're also going to be doing with the base, and I think it's going to be an informative meeting, so I plan on attending that tomorrow, again, with Jack and Steve. Again, I am going to be scheduling, and I hope that Owen's going to be sending out emails. We need to get this coastal zone management, coastal resource committee up and running. We need to get that ordinance on. I apologize again. The storm definitely had an impact on us being able to meet last week. But we're going to need to go forward. So when you see an email request come in from Owen, he'll have a couple of dates on there. I don't really anticipate these being long meetings. I think I'm going to shoot for first on a Wednesday. If we start at 10, we may be able to schedule this workshop at 11, especially if the agenda is shot short. But again, it's important to me that we have some input from not only staff. I think we talked about having Mike McGuire over here and his group, but also members of the Cape Cod Commission staff. So you will be seeing a request coming forward on that because we need to move forward. And that's it. With that, I'm going to go to Jack. Got anything?
Yeah, I'm glad you brought the CRC up. We, Christy, myself, and Mike McGuire met last week to talk about what the mission statement and the objectives should be of the new commission. And we're going to try to write something up for you this week and get it to you before the weekend.
I'll try. I have some draft stuff, too. I'll send it to you. You know, you can do whatever you want with it. But I was just trying to put something together to have when we have that first meeting handout, as I always do. So.
Great.
Okay.
And just a couple of things. Mike and Phil were very humble in their presentation. As Sean said, this was 5 days of conference calls. And the patience and the professionals during these conference calls that Sean and Phil handle, especially when Phil was dealing with some complicated sheltering issues, was really commendable. What else was commendable is the way they kept the media involved. I know Jeff was always invited to participate in the conference calls. Low Cape TV took a huge role in keeping the people in the other Cape involved. This time they joined all the conference calls as well. And I actually had a lovely email the other day from Bob Fellows from Cape Cod Today, who said he had no problem getting information from the center, and that helped him immeasurably. So they did a lot of great things. RTA setting up the 5 buses across the Cape was a tremendous asset to getting people to shelters and taking some pressure off of fire. So I can't thank Sean, Phil, Mike Walker, and the whole team up there, the AmeriCorps team, for the great efforts that they did throughout. I just want to point out, too, that last night, given the fact that there was a light pole down in my family homestead's front yard, I had a long opportunity to talk to the crew chief of that particular crew who had been out since Friday morning. And he said that they had only one complaint from Cape Codders this whole weekend. And I think that's commendable that everybody had the patience to put up with it, because Eversource really did work their tail off this weekend. And I thought all in all did a great job getting people back quickly. So that's it.
One complaint?
One to this particular crew.
Oh, okay.
This particular crew.
I'm a county commissioner. I had nothing to do with the electricity, and I got over 60 complaints all weekend.
Yeah.
Are you kidding me? People were calling me up saying, how come my electricity's still out? I don't know. What are you calling me for? I got nothing to do with that.
Well, Howard, quite frankly, seemed to get really hammered.
Yeah,
and
we did.
I know that the shelter down in Howard's, the Upper Cape School, was probably the most active, all in all.
But the interesting thing, I just want to add one other thing, the funny, because you brought it up with comments. I got people who called me that were upset that they were getting robocalls telling them that the electricity was out. Then I had people calling me saying, why aren't I getting robocalls telling me the electricity's out? There's no way of keeping people happy. I'm sorry. There's just no way of keeping people happy.
Sean actually brought that up this morning. We have a new regional management coming in for Eversource, and we're going to talk to Bob Smith about that. Robocall system.
Some people loved it, some people hated it. Some people wanted it, some people didn't want it. It was funny. Okay, do you have questions or anything? Steve, you have anything for us?
I'll just echo what Jack said. Phil, Sean, and Mike Walker did a phenomenal job running that whole shelter. I went up a few times, just checked in on them, and just to see it all operate and for the length of time they had to be there and the commitment they had. It was a really well-run operation. Just a little bit of storm damage we actually had here. We had a tree fall thankfully missed the building next door to us. That's being dealt with today. We had some shingles blow off the roof of this building. They were up patching yesterday, and they're going to continue to patch on Friday. I pulled them off the roof today and tomorrow just because of the wind. But there's some, we probably lost maybe a square of shingles, so we're just patching them back in. Both dredges were fine throughout the storm. They were able to tuck and hide them, and no issues there with the dredge. So
excellent.
That was it.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Owen, if you can remind me, on the county administrator's report number 10, I'd like to make the agenda from now on read county administrator's / staff report, because I want to give the opportunity in case department heads want to come in and just give us an update. It's not going to be something that we would deliberate and have a vote on, but just give the staff an opportunity to come in as we've been doing, but I think the agenda should reflect it a little bit more clearly. So maybe make 10 read the county administrator's / staff, county staff report, and that way there we can do things like we did with Phil and Sean. I'll be looking for a motion to adjourn unless there's anything else.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you.